not a good thing. The people that say it's not a good thing are most likely the people that don't buy my records.
That's an easy way to play the song, man. Holler at your boy.
Trying to hear it. Smoking mad Newports, cause I'm doing court for an assault that I caught in Bridgeport, New York. Catch me if you can, like the gingerbread man. You better have your cat in hand, cause man.
Gingerbread man? Okay. I don't know what that's supposed to mean, but okay. I don't know what gingerbread is. Unless you're trying to say Gengar bread. In which case, I think that's kind of a... I don't know, how'd that even work? You have a ghost in an oven. You're trying to make it into bread. What can ghost... Been really, really quiet for you? Oh, I turned down the mic the other day because you're... Here, is this better? I turned it up just a little. You're gonna get my... It says it's getting my fan and, like, some background noise. Who's he talking? Hello? Can you hear me? Can you guys really hear me? I'm just... Hello? Hold up. Let me check something. Yeah, it's this mic. I can kind of hear the... Okay. I'm turning up all the way, but you're definitely going to get background noise. Like, I don't want there to be too much background noise. I guess I gotta turn the fan off, but I really don't want to. It's kind of hot in here earlier. Okay, so both of you can now hear me. Okay. Is the background noise going to be okay, or is that going to be annoying? Because if it's not going to fly, then I'm just going to... Oh, maybe I can move it. I couldn't hear the fan. Background fine. Okay, well, if it's not showing up at your end, then why not? Just let me check one thing. Just let me do one thing real quick. By the way, so... Okay, background's fine. So how are you two? How is life treating everybody? It's been a pretty interesting day on my end. Kinda. Yeah, kinda. I'd say kinda. Just had group therapy. You're fine? That's awesome to hear. Glad to hear. Fine. Awesome. Hell. Somebody must be using that as a bookmark earlier. How about you? I'm alright. Like I said, I was starting group therapy today, and that's a bit of a change from one-on-one, obviously. But I don't know, it's kind of interesting. Like it's just like four like-minded people, so. Right. Jeez, this book's kind of dusty. Again, it's been sitting on a shelf for God knows how long, so... Sorry, I'm just kind of all over the place. You have no pistachios. Aw. I'm sorry to hear that. Well, hopefully this story will make you feel better. So, as you can tell from the title, this is The Thief Lord. This is a book, I think I got it at a book fair or something, when I was a very, very little kid. And I tried to read it, but I wasn't really big into reading back then. I mean, hell, I'm still not really that big into reading, but regardless. So I let it go for years. Then I picked it up and I just fell in love with it. Like, I can't really even... I can't even really explain how it is. And then I figured out they actually made a movie about it, like 13 or so years ago, so now I kind of want to watch that, because, like, oh my god, it was just something about this book, I don't even know, I don't even recall most of it, because it's just been that long since I've read it, but, yeah, I'm just surprised a paperback copy lasted this long. All right. Well, I think that's enough stall. I think that's enough stalling. So I think I'm just gonna get right into it. All right. Whatever. Alright. The Thief Lord. Chapter 1. Victor's New Clients. It was autumn in Venice when Victor first heard of Prosper and Beau. The canals, gleaming in the sun, dappled the ancient brickwork with gold. But the wind was blowing ice-cold air from the sea, reminding the Venetians that winter was approaching. Even the air in the alleyways tasted of snow, and only the wings of the carved angels and the dragons high up on the rooftops felt any real warmth from the pale sun. The house in which Victor lived and worked stood close to a canal, so close, in fact, that the water lapped against its walls. At night, he sometimes dreamed that the house was sinking into the waves, and that the sea would wash away the causeway that Venice clings to, breaking the thin thread that binds the city to Italy's mainland. In his dream, the city would sweep the lagoon away too, swallowing everything, the houses, the bridges, the churches, the palaces, and the people who had built so boldly on its surface. For the time being, however, the city still stood firmly on its wooden legs. Victor leaned against his window and looked out through the dusty glass. Surely no other place on earth was more proud of its beauty than Venice. And as he watched its spires and domes, each caught the sun as if trying to outshine one another. Whistling a tune, Victor turned away from the window and walked over to his large mirror. Just the weather for trying to figure out his new disguise, he thought. And as the sun warmed the back of his sturdy neck, he had bought this new treasure only the previous day. An enormous mustache, so dark and bushy that it would have made any self-respecting walrus extremely jealous. He stuck it carefully under his nose and stood on his toes to make himself taller. He turned to the left, to the right, and became so engrossed in his reflection that he only heard the footsteps on the stairs when they were stopped outside his door. Clients. Blast. Why were they bothering him now, of all times? With a deep sigh, he sat behind the desk. He heard voices whispering outside the door. They were probably admiring his nameplate, Victor thought. A handsome, black, shiny sign, with his name engraved in gold letters. Victor Goetz, private detective. Investigations of any kind. It was written in three languages. After all, he often had clients from abroad. Next to the sign was a knocker. A lion's head with a brass ring in its mouth, which Victor had polished just that morning. What are they waiting for? He thought, tapping his fingers on the armrest of his chair. Avanti! He called out. Come in! The door opened. A man and a woman stepped into Victor's office, which also doubled as his living room. They looked around warily, taking in the cacti, the beard and the mustache collection. The coat stand bursting with Victor's caps, hats, and wigs, the huge street map of Venice on the wall, and the winged lion that served as a paperweight on Victor's desk. "Do you speak English?" asked the woman, although her Italian sounded quite fluent. "Of course," Victor answered, gesturing toward the chairs in front of his desk. "English is my mother tongue. What can I do for you?" They both sat down hesitantly. The man folded his arms and looked rather sullen. The woman stared at Victor's walrus mustache. "Oh, that's just for camouflage," he explained, pulling the mustache from his lip. "Quite a necessity in my line of work. Well, what can I do for you? Anything lost or stolen? Any pet runaway?" Without saying a word, the woman reached into her bag. She had an ash blonde hair and pointed nose. Her mouth didn't look as if smiling was its favorite activity. The man was a giant, at least two full heads taller than Victor. His nose was peeling from sunburn, and his eyes were small and dull. Doesn't look like he could take a joke either, Victor thought, as he committed to the two faces to memory. He could never remember a phone number, but he never forgot a face. "This is what we've lost," said the woman as she pushed the photograph across the desk. Her English was even better than her Italian. Two boys looked out at Victor from the photograph. One was small and blonde with a broad smile on his face. The other was older, dark-haired, and more serious-looking. He had his arm around the younger boy's shoulder, as if he wanted to protect him for all that was evil in the world. "Children," Victor looked up in surprise. "I've tracked down a lot of things in my time. Suitcases, dogs, a couple of escaped lizards, and some husbands. But you are the first clients to come to me because they've lost their children, Mr. and Mrs.," he looked at them inquisitively. "Hartlieb," the woman answered. "Esther and Max Hartlieb. And they are not our children," her husband stated firmly, which immediately earned him an angry look from his pointy-nosed wife. "Prosper and Boniface are my late sister's sons," she explained. She raised the boys on her own. Prosper had just turned 12, and Bo was 5. "Prosper and Boniface," murmured Victor. "Unusual names. Doesn't Prosper mean the lucky one?" Esther Hartlieb arched her eyebrows. "Does it? Well, one thing's for sure. They're very strange names, and that's putting it mildly. My late sister had a fondness for anything peculiar. When she died 3 months ago, my husband and I applied for custody of Bo, since we sadly don't have any children of our own, but we couldn't possibly have taken on his older brother as well. Any reasonable person could see that. But Prosper got very upset, acting like a lunatic, accusing us of stealing his brother, although we would have allowed him to visit Bo once a month." Her pale face grew even paler. "What's that, bud?" "That's just Dodgy asking for attention. They ran away more than 8 weeks ago," Max Hartlieb continued, "from their grandfather's house in Hamburg, well, where they were staying at the time. Prosper's quite capable of talking his brother into any foolish scheme. And everything we have found out so far indicates that he has brought them here, to Venice." "From Hamburg to Venice?" Victor raised his eyebrows. "That's a long way for two children to travel on their own. Have you contacted the police here?" "Of course we have," hissed Esther Hartlieb. "There were no help at all. Surely it can't be that hard to find two children who are all alone." But her husband cut her off. "Sadly, I have to return home on urgent business. We would therefore like to put you in charge of the search of the boys, Mr. Goetz. The concierge at our hotel recommended you." "How nice of him," Victor mumbled. He fiddled with his false mustache. The thing looked like a dead mouse lying next to the phone. "But what makes you so sure they come to Venice? Surely they didn't come just to run in the gondolas." "It's their mother's fault." Mrs. Hartley pursed her lips and glanced out through Victor's dirty window. Outside on the balcony, the wind was ruffling. "Off, off, 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 off. Sorry, Dodgy has a peculiar habit of jumping on my computer at the worst possible times because he wants attention. You're bad. All right? Everyone, put down that Dodgy's a bad boy in the chat. Show him that he's a bad boy. Bork. No, Goggle, that's not the noise he makes. Alright, I'm just going to start from... "It's their mother's fault." Mrs. Hartley pursed her lips and glanced out through Victor's dirty window. Outside, on the balcony, the wind was ruffling the feathers of a pigeon. "My sister kept telling the boys about the city. She told them stories about winged lions, a golden cathedral, about the angels and dragons perched on top of buildings. She told them that water nymphs came ashore for walks at night up the little steps on the edges of the canals." She shook her head angrily. My sister could talk about these things in a way that almost made me believe her. "It was Venice this, Venice that, nothing but Venice. bow drew winged lions all the time, and Prosper simply drank in every word his mother said. He probably thought that if you could make it to Venice, he and Bo could land right in the middle of fairyland. What an idea. She wrinkled her nose and cast a contemptuous look through a window at the crumbling plaster of the neighboring houses. Mr. Hartley Ebb adjusted his tie. It's cost us a lot of money to trace the boys this far, Mr. Getz, he said. And I can assure you that they are here, somewhere, in this filth, Mrs. Hartley Ebb finished her husband's sentence for him. Well, at least there aren't any cars here to run them over, Victor said under his breath. He looked up at the street map on the wall and started the maze of lines and canals that made Venice so unique. Then turning back to look at his desk, deep in thought, he started scratching doodles onto its surface with his letter opener. Mr. Hartley Ebb cleared his throat. Mr. Getz, will you take the case on? Victor looked once more at the photograph, the two very different faces. The tall, serious boy, and the carefree smile of the younger one. And then he nodded. Yes, I'll take it, he said. I will find them. They look a little too young to be coping on their own. Tell me, did you ever run away as children? For heaven's sake, of course I didn't! Esther Hartley Ebb looked flabbergasted. Her husband just shook his head as if it was the strangest thing he'd ever heard. Well, I did, Victor wedged the photograph under the winged lion. But I was by myself. I didn't have a brother, big or small, to look after me. Well, leave me your address and telephone number, and let's talk about my fee. As the Hartley Ebbs struggled back down a narrow staircase, Victor stepped onto the balcony. A cold wind whipped at his face, bearing the salty tang of the nearby sea. Shivering, he leaned against the balustrade and watched the Hartley Ebbs step onto a bridge a few houses down, further down the canal. It was a pretty bridge, but the couple seemed not to take any notice of it. They rushed across it sullenly, without even a glance at the scrawny dog barking at them for a passing barge. And, of course, they didn't spit into the canal, like Victor always did. Well, who says you have to like your clients? The detective muttered to himself. He leaned over a cardboard box on the floor on the balcony, out of which the heads of two tortoises were peeking. Parents like that are still better than no parents at all, right? What do you think? Don't tortoises have parents? Victor looked through the balustrade of the canal below, and at the houses whose stony feet were washed by the water day in, day out. He had lived in Venice for more than 15 years, and he still didn't know how to see all the city's nooks and crannies. But then again, no one did. The job wouldn't be easy. Particularly if the boys didn't want to be found. There were so many hiding places, and so many narrow alleys with names no one could remember, some of which had no names at all. Boarded up churches, deserted houses. The whole city was one huge invitation to play hide and seek. Well, I've always liked playing hide and seek, thought Victor, and so far I've found everyone I've ever looked for. The two boys have already been coping alone for 8 weeks. 8 weeks! When he had run away from home, he only managed to cope with his freedom for one afternoon. At dusk, he had slunk back home, feeling sad and sorry for himself. The tortoises nibbled at the lettuce leaf Victor was holding out to them. I think I'd better take you inside tonight, he says. This wind tastes of winter. Lando and Paula looked at him through their lashless eyes. He sometimes got them mixed up, but he didn't seem to mind. He had found them one day at a fish market, where he had gone in search of a client's Persian cat. Once Victor had managed to fish the pedigreed out of the barrel full of stinking sardines and stowed her in a scratch-safe box, he had discovered two tortoises. They had been meandering between all the human feet, completely oblivious to the world. When Victor picked them up, When Victor picked him up, they quickly retreated into their shells. Where shall I start? Victor wondered. In the orphanages? The hospitals? They're such sad places. But maybe I don't need to begin here, there. The Hartley Ebbs have probably done that already. He leaned over the balcony and spat into the dark canal. Poe, Beau, and Prosper. Nice names, he thought, even if they are a little unusual. Chapter 2. Three Children. The Hartley Ebbs had been right. Prosper and Beau had indeed managed to get to Venice. They had traveled a long way, squatting in rattling trains, hiding from conductors and nosy old ladies. They had locked themselves into stinking toilets, slept in dark corners, squeezed tightly together, hungry, tired, and frozen. But they had done it, and they were still together. At exactly the same time, their Aunt Esther was sitting down on a chair in front of Victor Goetz's desk. The two boys were standing in a doorway just a few steps from the Rialto Bridge. The cold wind blew in their faces. There was no doubt about it. The warm days were gone. Esther had been wrong about one thing. Prosper and Beau were not alone. There was a girl with them. She was slender and had brown hair, which she wore in a long, thin braid that went right down to her hips and looked like a long stinger. It had given her the nickname Hornet. She had never answered to anything else. The girl was frowning as she stared at a crumpled piece of paper. People pushed past her, ramming their full shopping bags into her back. "I think we've got everything," she had said in a quiet, slightly hoarse voice. Prosper had liked that voice as soon as he heard Hornet speak, even before he'd been able to understand much of what she was saying. At first, he remembered just a few words of Italian that his mother had taught him along with her stories of Venice, but he'd had to learn fast. "Now there's just the batteries from Mosca. Where can we get those?" Prosper pushed his bangs out of his face. "There's a hardware store back in that side alley," he said. He saw that Beau was hunching up his shoulders against the cold, so he turned up his brother's collar. The children pushed back into a crowd. It was market day at the Rialto, and the narrow alleys were even more crowded than usual. Men and women, young and old, were squashed between the stalls, most of them laden with bags and parcels, everyone trying to squeeze past one another. There were old ladies who had probably never left the city, weaving their way around the tourists. The air smelled of fish, autumn flowers, and dried mushrooms. "Hornet?" Beau reached for her hand and gave her his sweetest smile. "Will you buy me one of those little cakes over there?" Hornet pinched his cheek and affectionately and shook her head. "No," she said firmly, pulling him along. The hardware store Prosper had discovered was tiny. In its window, between coffee machines and toasters, stood a few toys. Beau gazed at them, his mouth open. But I'm hungry," he moaned, pressing his hands against the glass. "You're always hungry," Prosper smiled. He opened the door and stayed with Beau near the entrance while Hornet walked up to the counter. The girl addressed an elderly lady who had her back turned to the counter and was dusting some radios. "Scusi, I need batteries. Two for a small radio." The lady packed the batteries in a paper bag and pushed a handful of candy across the counter. "What a sweet boy," she said, winking at Beau. "Fair as an angel. Is he your brother?" Hornet shook her head. "No, they're my cousins. They're just visiting." Prosper pushed Beau behind his back, but the boy slipped through his brother's arms and snatched the candy from the counter. "Grazie," he said. He smiled at the old lady and hopped back to Prosper. The lady smiled. "Un vero angelo." She put Hornet's money into the register. But his mother should darn his pants and dress him in warmer clothes. "Winter is coming. Didn't you hear the wind in the chimneys today?" "We'll tell her." Hornet stuffed the batteries into her full shopping bag. "Have a nice day, signora." "Angelo, huh?" Prosper shook his head as they pushed their way back into the crowd. "How come they always fall for you, Beau?" His little brother just stuck his tongue out at him and skipped ahead. The two older children had to struggle to keep up with him as he nimbly wove his way through all the legs and bodies. "Not so fast, Bo," Prosper shouted after him. Horna just laughed. "Leave him," she said. "We won't lose him. See? He's right there." Bo made a face. He tried to hop around an orange he'd seen on the ground, but he stumbled and crashed into a group of Japanese tourists. Startled, he scampled up again, only to start smiling as soon as he saw that two of the women were pointing their cameras at him. But before they could take their pictures, Prosper was already dragging his brother away by the collar. "How often do I have to tell you not to let yourself get photographed?" he hissed at him. Bo pulled away from Prosper's hand and skipped over an empty cigarette pack. "But they were Japanese! Aunt Esther won't look at Japanese photographs, will she? And you said she was going to adopt another boy anyway." Prosper nodded and mumbled, "Yes." But he couldn't help looking around as if he expected his aunts to be lurking in the crowd, just waiting for a chance to grab Bo. Hornet noticed the look on Prosper's face. "You're thinking about your aunt again, aren't you?" she whispered, although Bo had wandered out of earshot again. "Forget her. She's not looking for you anymore. And even if she is, then she wouldn't be looking here, would she?" Prosper shrugged. He cast an uncomfortable glance at the couple of women passing by. "Probably not," he murmured. But Hornet insisted. "Definitely not. So stop worrying." Prosper nodded, although he knew he wouldn't be able to stop. Every night, while Bo slept soundly as a kitten, Prosper dreamed of Esther. Upright, nervous, hairspray sticky Esther. "Hey, Prop!" Bo suddenly stopped in front of him again. He held up a full wallet towards Prosper. "Look what I found." Prosper snatched the wallet from his brother's hand and pulled him into a dark arcade away from the crowd. "Where'd you get that, Bo?" Hornet had followed them behind in a pile of old crates. A couple of pigeons were pecking at bits of squashed fruit on the ground. Bo pushed out his lower lip defiantly, silkily holding onto Hornet's arm. "I found it! I told you, a big bald man dropped it out of his pocket. He didn't even notice. And then I found it." Prosper sighed. Since they had begun to fend for themselves, Prosper had to learn how to steal. Only food at first, but then money too. He hated it. He always got scared and his fingers started to tremble every time. Bo, however, thought it was an exciting game. Prosper had forbidden his brother to steal anything, and he told him off very harshly every time he caught him. He certainly didn't want to give Esther a chance to say that he had turned his little brother into a thief. "Calm down, Prop," Hornet said, giving Bo a cuddle. "He told you he didn't steal it, and the man is long gone. At least have a look and see how much is in it." Reluctantly, Prosper opened the wallet. The visitors who came to Venice to see the palaces and churches were always losing things. Mostly just bottles of water or the cheap carnival masks that you could buy on any street corner. But every now and then, the strap of the camera would snap or a handful of change would fall out of someone's pocket, and sometimes even a wallet like this. Prosper leafed through the compartments, but there were only a few 100 lire. Oh shit, how does that go? Lire? I think it's lire. The compartments were only a few 1,000 lire notes stuck in between the crumbled receipts, restaurant bills, and used Vaporetto tickets. So you probably don't know what lire are, so I should probably explain that. Before the EU was a thing, well, no, I think this was even way before that, lire was the official Italian currency. It was kind of like yen, where even if you had a large amount, it was basically nothing. I remember a story of my grandmother getting a inheritance. I think she got like something like 26,000 lire. or something like that, and I think it was only like $30. So, yeah. Well, it would have been nice. Horton couldn't hide her disappointments as Prosper threw the wallets into an empty crate. Our cash box is nearly empty. Let's hope the thief lord can fill it up again tonight. Of course he will. Beau looked at Horn as if she had doubted that the earth was round. And one day I'm going to help him. I'm going to be a big thief. Scipio will teach me. Over my dead body, Prosper grumbled, pushing Beau back into the alley. It's okay, Hornet whispered to Prosper. Beau was trotting ahead of him, looking deeply insulted. You don't really think Scipio is going to take them along on a raid, do you? Prosper shook his head, but he was still worried. Keeping an eye on Beau was difficult. Ever since they had run away from their grandfather's house, Prosper had asked himself at least 3 times a day whether he had been right to take his little brother with him. On that night, 8 weeks ago, Beau had trailed alongside him with sleepy eyes. He had held on to his big brother's hand all the way to the station. Getting to Venice had been easier than Prosper had expected. But it was already autumn when they had arrived in the city, and the air had not been as warm and gentle as Prosper had imagined it to be. A damp wind had greeted them as they climbed down the steps of the station, blowing right through their thin clothes. All they had with them was a small bag and a backpack. Prosper's allowance hadn't lasted long, and after the second night, Beau had already started coughing so badly that Prosper had to take him by the hand and go find a policeman. He had determined to use a few bits of Italian he had learned from his mother and to say, "Scusi, we've run away from home, but my brother is sick. Could you call my aunt so she can come pick him up?" He had been desperate. And then Hornet had appeared. She had taken him to her hiding place, where they meet Riccio and Mosca, and had given him dry clothes and something hot to eat. Then she explained to Prosper that they should forget about stealing and being cold. As from now on, Scipio, the thief lord, would look after them, just like he looked after Hornet and her friends. "The others are probably waiting for us." Hornet's voice startled Prosper out of his thoughts, and for a moment he didn't know where he was. The smells of coffee and sweet pastries wafted at him from the houses. Their home had smelled very different. "I bet we'll still have to clean up," said Beau. "Scipio doesn't like it when the hideout is messy." "You can talk," Prosper mocked. "Who spilled the bucket full of canal water yesterday?" "And he always leaves out some cheese from the mice," Hornet giggled as Beau gave her a shove with his elbow, even though he knows the thief lord hates nothing more than mouse droppings. "It's too bad that the wonderful hideout he's found for us is all full of them, and that it's so difficult to keep the place warm. Perhaps something less grand would have been more practical, but of course our thief lord wouldn't have it any other way." "The Star Palace," Beau corrected her. He ran after the other two as they turned into a less crowded alley. "Scipio says it's called the Star Palace." Hornet rolled her eyes. "Watch it," she whispered to Prosper. "Soon Beau won't listen to you at all anymore, only to what Scipio tells him." "And what can I do about it?" Prosper replied sulkily. Prosper knew perfectly well that it was only thanks to Scipio I'm a master of the Italiano. "Well, what if Roughly didn't know, huh? And what can I do about it?" Prosper replied sulkily. Prosper knew perfectly well that it was only thanks to Scipio that they didn't have to sleep on the streets anymore. Especially now when in the evenings a cold mist hung over the alleys and the canals. Scipio's raids paid for their pasta and their fresh fruit. Scipio brought the shoes that were keeping Beau's feet warm, even though they were a bit big for him. Scipio made sure they could eat without having to always steal for it. Scipio had given them a home again. A home without Esther. But still, Scipio was a thief. The alleys, they walked through became narrower. It was quiet between the houses, and soon they entered the hidden heart of the city, where there were hardly any strangers. Cats darted away as their footsteps rang out in the paving stones. Pigeons cooed from the roofs, the ever-present water spray beneath the bridges, splashing against boats and wooden posts, and reflecting back the old faces of the houses. The children wandered deeper and deeper into the maze of alleys. The house seemed to be moving in on them, watching them, as if they knew who they were. Their hiding place was in a building that stood out from its neighbors like a child among grown-ups, low and flat between the taller houses. Boarded-up windows looked out into the alley. The walls were covered with old, yellowish film posters, and the entrance was blocked off with rusty shutters. A big, crooked sign hanging above the entrance read Stella. The movie theater's neon sign had been lit up for a long time, but that suited its current inhabitants just fine. Hornet cast a careful glance up and down the alley, while Prosper made sure no one was watching them from the surrounding windows. Then they vanished, one by one, into the narrow passageway that opened up a few steps down from the movie theater's main entrance. They were home. Yeah, okay, I'll do chapter 3. Chapter 3. The Star Palace. A water rat scuttled away as the children felt their way along the narrow passage. It led to a canal, like so many of Venice's alleys and passages. Hornet, Prosper, and Beau, however, only followed as far as a metal door set in a windowless wall to their right. Someone had painted Vietato Ingresso in clumsy letters on it. No entry. The door had once been one of the movie theater's emergency exits. Now it was the entrance to a hiding place that only 6 children knew anything about. Next to the door was a cord, and Prosper gave it 2 strong tugs. He waited for a moment and then pulled it once more. This was their sign, but it still took quite a while before something happened. Beau hopped impatiently from one foot to the other. Finally, the door opened just a crack and a suspicious voice asked, "Password?" "Come on, Riccio. You know we never remember the stupid password," Prosper grumbled angrily. Hornet stepped up to the door and hissed. "Do you see these bags in my hands, Hedgehog? I just dragged them all the way from the Rialto Market. My arms are as long as a monkey's, so open the door." Riccio opened the door, looking very worried. Okay, but only if Prosper doesn't tell Scipio again like last time. Riccio was a scrawny boy, and at least a head shorter than Prosper, although he wasn't much younger than him. At least, that's what he claimed. His brown hair always stuck out from his head in every direction, earning him the nickname Riccio the Hedgehog. "No one can remember Scipio's passwords," Horton muttered as she pushed past him. "And anyway, the special ring is enough." "Scipio doesn't think so," Riccio carefully pushed the bolt across the door. "Well, then he shouldn't make up passwords we can remember. Can't you remember the last one?" Riccio scratched his spiky head. "Hold on. Catago diddle do east, or something like that." Hornet rolled her eyes. Beau giggled. Riccio walked ahead, shining the way with his flashlight. "We've already started cleaning up," he said, "but we haven't gotten far. Mosca just wants to fiddle with the radio all the time. And until an hour ago, we were standing in front of the Palazzo Pisani." "I really don't know why Scipio had to pick such a palace of all places for his next raid. There's something going on in there nearly every night. Parties, receptions, dinners. All the wealthy families of Venice seem to be in and out all the time. Beats me how Scipio thinks he can get in there." Prosper shrugged. So far, the thief lord hadn't asked him and Beau to stake out one of his targets, although Beau kept begging him to. It was usually Riccio and Mosca who were sent to check out the houses Scipio planned to visit at night. Scipio had picked a name for the two of them, He called them his eyes. Hornet's task was to make sure that the money from his raids was not spent too quickly. Prosper and Beau, as the thief lord's most recent charges, had so far only been allowed to tag along when the loot was sold, or, like today, to do some shopping. Prosper didn't mind it at all. Beau, however, would have loved to sneak with Scipio into the city's most elegant houses to steal all the amazing things the thief lord always brought back with from his raids. Scipio can get into any house, Beau said, skipping along next to Riccio. Two hops on his right leg, two on the left. Beau never just walked. He ran or he bounced. He ran the Doge's palace and wasn't caught. He is the thief lord. Oh yes, the raid of the Doge's palace. How could we ever forget? Hornet grinned at Prosper. Even you must have heard that story 100 times by now. Prosper had to smile back. Well, I could hear it 1,000 times, Riccio said, pushing aside a dark and musty curtain. Ahead of him lie the movie theater's auditorium. It hadn't been open to the public for some time. It was not very old, but it was in much worse condition than some of the city's houses that had stood for hundreds of years. Dusty wire cables stuck out from the ceiling where there had been large chandeliers. The children had strung a few naked light bulbs running on batteries throughout the large room, and even in their dim light you could see the plaster coming off the ceiling. Only the front 3 rows of seats remained, and each of those was missing a few chairs. Mice had built their nests in the soft red upholstery. The movie theater screen was hidden behind a thick curtain embroidered with golden stars. The curtain was moth-eaten, but it kept its old splendor. The golden thread on the pale blue fabric still shimmered full of promise, and Beau had to touch the golden stars at least once every day. Goggled. Sitting on the bare floor in front of the curtain was a boy. He was fiddling with an old radio and so engrossed in his work he hadn't even noticed Beau creeping up on him. Beau jumped onto his back and the boy spun around. Darn it, Beau, he shouted. I nearly stabbed myself with a screwdriver. But Beau skipped away. Laughing, he climbed like a squirrel onto the folding seats. Just you wait, you little water rat, Mosca roared, trying to catch Beau. This time I'm going to tickle you until you burst. Beau screamed, Prop, help me! But Prosper just stood there, grinning. He didn't lift a finger, not even when Mosca tucked his little brother under his arm like a parcel. Mosca was the biggest and strongest of them all, and however much Beau kicked and struggled, Mosca wouldn't let go. Unimpressed by his wrinkling, Mosca carried this prisoner to the others. My apologies. What do you think? Should I tickle him, or should I keep him prisoner here forever, under my arm? Beau screamed, Let me go, Mosca! Mosca's skin was beautifully black. Riccio always claimed he could hide like a shadow in the dark alleyways of the city. Alright, I will pardon you this time, dwarf, Mosca said grandly while Beau tried more and more desperately to free himself. Then he asked, So, did you bring the paint from my boat? No, it's too expensive. We'll try to buy it when Scipio brings us a new loot, Hordish answered. She dumped the bags on a chair. We can't afford it at the moment. But we got enough emergency cash. Mosca put Beau back on his feet and crossed his arms angrily. What are you going to do with all that money? How often do I have to tell you? The money is for bad times. Hornet put Beau to her side. Do you think you can manage to put the things in the fridge? Beau nodded and dashed off, nearly falling flat on his face. He dragged the bags one by one to the double doors that used to let in the audience. Beyond the doors, in the entrance hall, was a large display cabinet that had once held drinks and ice cream. Although it didn't work anymore, it was still useful for storing supplies. While Beau carried away the heavy bags, Mosca kneeled down in front of the radio again. Too expensive, he grumbled. My boat will rot away soon if I don't paint it. But you guys don't care, because you're just a bunch of landlubbers. There's always enough money for Hornet's books. Hornet didn't answer that. Silently, she began to collect paper and other trash from the floor while Prosper swept up the mouse droppings. Hornet really did have a lot of books. She had even bought some of them, but mostly they were cheap paperbacks that had been thrown away by tourists. Hornet fished them out of trash cans and waste paper baskets, or she found them under the streets of Vaporetto boats, or at the train station. You could hardly see her mattress behind the stacks of books. They all had their beds close together in the back of the movie theater. At night, after they'd switched off all the lights and blown out the last candle, the large, windowless auditorium would be flooded with such complete darkness that it made them feel as tiny as ants, and very lost. But the sounds of one another's breathing made them all feel a little safer. Riccio's mattress was covered with old comic books, and his sleeping bag was stuffed with so many stuffed animals that there was hardly any space left for him. Mosca's bed could easily be spotted by his toolbox and fishing rods, which he liked to sleep next to. Tucked under the pillow was Mosca's greatest treasure, his lucky charm. This was a brass seahorse, exactly like the ones that adorned most gondolas in the city. Mosca swore that he hadn't stolen it from a gondola, but instead fished it from a canal behind a movie theater. A stolen lucky charm, he always claimed, brings only bad luck. Everybody knows that. Bo and Prosper huddled together every night on a single mattress. Bo's collection of plastic fans was lined up neatly at the top end. There were six of them, all in pretty good shape, but Bo's favorite was still the one Prosper had found at the station on the day they arrived. Bo and Prosper huddled together. Oh, wait, no, I read that. The thief lord never slept with his followers in the Star Palace. No one knew where Scipio spent the nights, and he never spoke about it, although every now and then he would drop a mysterious hint about an abandoned church. Riccio had tried to follow him once, but he'd been spotted immediately by Scipio, who had gotten so angry that afterward none of them even dared to watch him when he left. Their leader came and went as he pleased, and they had gotten used to it. He sometimes turned up 3 days in a row, and then they wouldn't see him again for nearly a week. But he did want to come that day, and when the thief lord announced a visit, he always came. Okay. But you can never be sure exactly when Scipio would appear. As Riccio's clock showed him almost 11 and Bo was nearly asleep on Prosper's lap, they crept under the blankets and Horn began to read to them. She usually read to make them sleepy, to drive away their fear of the dreams that were waiting for them in the dark. That night, however, Hornet read to keep them awake until Scipio's arrival. She selected the most thrilling story from her pile of books while the others lit the candles that stood in empty bottles and jars among the mattresses. Riccio placed 5 brand new candles in their only real candlestick. They were long and slender and made from pale wax. Riccio, Hornet asked when they were all lying around her, waiting for their story. Where did you get the candles? Riccio self-consciously hid his face between his soft toys. From the Salute Church, he mumbled. There are hundreds, probably thousands lying around there, so it really doesn't matter if I take a few every now and then. Why should we spend our precious money on candles? I swear, he grinned at Hornet. I always blow the Virgin Mary a kiss for each one. Hornet buried her face in her hands and sighed. Oh, go on, start reading, Mosca said impatiently. No carabiniere will ever arrest Riccio for stealing a few candles, would he? They could, mumbled Bo. He yawned and curled up next to Prosper, who was struggling with the needle and thread over the holes in his brother's pants. Because Riccio's guardian angel will look after him if he steals things from a church. He's not allowed to. Pah! Trash. Guardian angel. Riccio made a contemptuous face, although he did sound a little worried. Hornet read for nearly an hour, while the night outside grew darker and all those who had filled the city with noise during the day were long in their beds. Finally, the book slipped from her fingers and her eyelids drooped. When Scipio finally arrived, they were all fast asleep. How long am I? Alright, I've been streaming for like an hour, and I can feel my mouth getting very, very dry. So I think we're going to stop it there for tonight, guys. Chapter 4. Oh, Dashi. Yes, you're a good boy. All right. Like I said, I think I'm going to stop it there. What do you guys think so far? Interesting book or not? I mean, should I continue this or should I do something else? I'd like some feedback. Also, I was thinking about changing up the schedule a bit. I think I'm just going to do like a poll on Twitter or something. And so you guys can just check it out there. The jelly in the description. You enjoyed it? Well, that's good. That's good to hear. Anyway, the jelly in the description will take you to my Twitter. Like I said, I'll put up a poll there regarding my schedule in the future because I kind of want to do more games. Penn would do well streaming a game like Quest for Glory. Actually, Delta got me one shot, and I was thinking about doing that game. So, I think that's going to be like my game series. I was thinking, because I still want to do the Book of Disquiet, and I don't know. Like, I want to do maybe, I still want to kind of keep to the 3-day schedule. So I was thinking, like, Tuesday I could do Thief Lord, Thursday the Book of Disquiet, and then Sunday I can make a game day. How does that sound for everyone? Does that sound okay? Or is that like, I don't know. Like I said, I'll do a poll. I'll come up with like various options and, you know, everyone can vote for it. Quest for Glory. I never heard of that game actually. Also, again, I apologize for the lack of any sort of, visualizer. I know that the GIF is, I mean, the GIF's pretty, but I don't know. It's still, my schedule's been all over the place, so I don't know. I've been there, done that, man. I know what them feels. Alright. Well, yeah. Again, where was I? Oh, yeah, the audio visualizer. I'm still testing some things out, so, you know, thank you for being patient with that. And, yeah, I think that's about it. Mitch Baby, IRL friend of mine, she followed before the stream, so I'd just like to thank her right now. Thank you so much. Yeah, you're awesome. And, yeah. Well, I think I said everything I need to. So, Old Sierra game. But there's a fan updated version. Huh, okay. I'll have to look into it. So, good night to you, Goggled. Good night, Roughly, if you're still here. Have a pleasant evening. And I'll see you all on Thursday. See ya.